Don't be surprised if I ask what a bag is.
Welcome to a new episode of, I was going to call it a special, but to be honest, we're going to be doing this a bit more frequently. So yeah, this is a WSL episode of Gold Diggers. I'm your host today, Moya, and my at is at Moya's Laboratory. And to my left, I've got
Marva at Marva MSK.
And on my right,
at Courtney.
Courtney
at Cat is 11. So
perfect. So yeah, we're just going to kick it off straight away. So the first thing we're actually going to touch on today, well, first of all, let's just say why we're doing this. A lot of us have been watching women's football, especially this year. The coverage has been so much more. And I feel like there's been lots of new eyes on women's football. And I thought, well, we need to get an episode done. So that's why we're basically doing this. And we're going to be doing them a lot more frequently now. So we're going to kick off basically talking about the title race that is happening right now in the WSL. Marva, thoughts on the title race?
Before we get into that, can I also say, I don't think it's a coincidence that us guys are currently so into women's football, given that the men's team that we support
is in disarray.
Two United fans and an Everton fan. At least you guys have some joy when it comes to women's. Unfortunately for me, it's just bad on all sides.
You've got that those Gary Lineker like, type days, that type of history to get back
on. Facts.
But back to women's football. So my thoughts, I just feel like for so long it was Arsenal's to lose. And I feel like they have lost it. And now it's in a place where it's Chelsea's to lose, and Chelsea are not the type of team to lose it.
And would you say that Chelsea have any matches that could potentially rock the title race again?
Who have they got coming up next?
They've still got to play Spurs twice. They're playing Spurs back to back.
I don't think that's it. I think they're geared for the title now.
Arsenal has to play Spurs too, right?
Yeah, once.
Got postponed.
Yeah.
And that's a bigger game as well in terms of the magnitude that it brings. I feel like I also feel like Spurs have dropped off a bit last few weeks. Their form's declined a little bit. Obviously, they've had a great season, but I don't think they're competing for that Champions League spot anymore, which before was looking like they could. So I feel like it is Chelsea's to lose right now, and also just because we know what Chelsea are like, we know what their mentality are like. I can see them maybe dropping a point here and there, like you said, possibly against Spurs, but I cannot see them dropping more points than Arsenal now.
Yeah. Courtney, thoughts?
I think Chelsea's geared for the title. I think the type of team that Emma Coach is 100%. The players that they have are big game players. And I think, especially if you look at United and how that they've not coped with those big situations against City, against Arsenal, that won't happen against Chelsea. They have too much experience, and the inexperienced players that they have are just quality. I think it is Chelsea's to lose.
I think you made a good point as well on managing games and game management in general. Sometimes when Chelsea are in games and it's not going their way, you already know, and they're gonna find a way. Like, it may not come from Sam Kerr, it may come from bloody, I don't know, Gura Wrighton. It could come from someone random, but that goal is coming. And I think that's what sets them apart. They look used to winning. They look used to winning stuff, and I think that's what sets them apart. And I think as well, that's where Arsenal have kind of stumbled. Because where would you say Arsenal started stumbling?
Well, I would also say with Arsenal, it's like they have a similar thing of they might be able to find a way, but by that point it's too late. So for example, like their game against United, their game against Spurs.
Spurs should have won that game.
Yes,
well.
They should have won it, but it's like fair play to Arsenal for coming back and getting those, well, the Spurs won the last minute equaliser.
Yeah.
But it's like, and then it's just Miedemar. Her assist against United as well.
I'm not going to lie.
just ridiculous.
It's not about 25 but, times every game.
But then I think that also shows you, not to say that Arsenal don't, not to say that Arsenal lack quality, but those big game players that will just bring that moment out. Miedema has that, and she did that against Spurs, and she did that against United. Yeah. But that gets them a point. That doesn't get them the 3 points. Yeah. Whereas when you look at Chelsea, they've got players to bring that out and get them the 3 points regardless of how they're playing.
Would you say that defence in general plays a big part of that, though? Like, I think, from what I've seen, Arsenal are more likely to go behind in a match than a Chelsea. And I don't know what that stems from. I don't know if that's from like a lack of concentration, if it's defence. Like, what are your thoughts on that?
Well, Arsenal's had a lot of changes in terms of their defence because Williamson's been in and out because of injured. And then they brought in a couple of players. Whereas if you look at Chelsea's back line, in terms of defence, Millie Bright, I think, is...
And she's had such a good season.
She's had such a both ends of the pitch as well.
I think this has been her best...
Yeah.
I always thought Millie Bright was good, but it's,
she was
it's
inconsistent as that's well. What I, and I always mistakes. Thought she had an error in her. Yeah.
Exactly that.
She's an old school defender, though. I think you see her when she plays for England is the confidence that she has this season, and I think that's what sets them apart. Because then you have like Jess Carter as well, who's had a good season. But whereas Arsenal's defence has changed a little bit, and I think that's what took City out of the running as well. That Ellie Roebuck not being there really, really affected earlier this season. True. So the defensive shape and having confidence.
And Bruns out as well.
Yeah, and having confidence in the defence. Yeah.
I think they had everyone in and City had everyone in the back five out except for Demi Stokes at one point. And I'll be real, like, look, I like Demi Stokes in it, but like, there's only so much Demi Stokes
can do
when everyone for them to have their centre for their goalkeeper first choice and second choice. Because remember, Bardi was out as well. They were using their first choice.
Did you see, wasn't it Stanway was...
playing right back.
No, she was even put as reserve goalkeeper.
Yeah. That's when I knew, curtains.
I mean, I swear she's like not that tall either.
But I think Stanway's one of those players that coaches don't know. She'll do anything for the team. No, I completely agree. I think, the instability that Arsenal have had with their back line obviously hasn't helped. And what you were saying on Millie Bright as well, I think is a good point because... Like, me personally, I love defenders with, like, some bulldog in them. Like, I want you to be a bit more...
Yeah.
Like, sometimes you see Millie Bright... Got the ball, She's already conceded that she's already going to win the ball, but she just decided, you know what, I'm going to push. I feel in my spirit that it's what I need to do in it. I just want to push someone. Cool.
Just leave something on them, isn't
it? Just a bit. Just not too much. Not too much to get a yellow, but, like... something so you know I'm there.
But that's what differentiates Chelsea from the other teams, because there's so many other teams in the WSL that don't do the things that champions do. And that's what I think sets Chelsea apart from the rest, because you know that if Millie Bright has to run into the post to stop that ball going in, she's going to run into the post and just take the treatment after. That's the type of defender that she is.
You're right. Marva, in terms of Arsenal in general this season, and what would for them be a successful season? So, for example, you guys have said that you think the league is slightly out of their hands now. We know it's out of their hands. In terms of what would constitute as a good season for them if they don't win the league, would you say that they have to win the FA Cup, or do you think they could not win the FA Cup and still have a good season?
It depends what you consider good. I mean, I don't think you could call it a successful season if they don't win the league or the cup and haven't gone out of the Champions League. That doesn't necessarily mean it's a bad season. It can still be a good season, especially like the improvement that they've made over this year. At the beginning of the season, you would probably still have said it would be City and Chelsea up there. For them to even be in the running, and also if they keep in the running down to the wire, I think that's still a sign of a good season and something that they can build on for next season, to be like they can go all out next season and give Chelsea a run for their money.
Nice, yeah.
If they now fall off, though, don't win the FA Cup, don't win the league, and finish in a position where it looks like Chelsea, it was comfortable for them anyway, then I think that also sets apart what's going to happen for them next season, because are they going to go into that thinking like, no, we're in it for the title, or is it going to be like, right, City are back now, that's just going to boss it?
That's the thing, because City will be.
City will be back.
And they've already started recruiting. The thing is with City as well, like, they've already started recruiting. So they already know what they're about. Yeah.
But it's because of the setup in general. I think the top three teams are the top three teams for a reason. And you have to look at the resources. You have to look at the facilities that
planning,
they have.
Yeah.
If you go to Cobham, if you go down to City's training ground, it's great facilities. Same with Arsenal. And that's the reason why the top three teams.
Yeah.
Tottenham were just, they just started providing food for their players. They had to make their own sandwiches.
Listen. I played for Spurs when I was younger, yeah. This isn't a good thing. When I saw them sign, like the players that they were signing, knowing the history of Spurs women, how I know it, when I would be like, as an under 12s player playing, like our training was in like an Enfield school or whatever. After us on the pitch, the second, the reserves, including some of the first team players, would come and train on that pitch in an Enfield school on a like Tuesday night.
Shout out Enfield.
We had no support from Spurs as a club. Like we essentially got to wear their shirt and it was like, great, cheers, see you later.
Done, box checked.
Literally, so I'm like, I have a soft spot and a bad spot for them, but the soft spot in me is like the fact that they're doing so well and that they've now clearly built a structure as well that it's not just a case of, okay, this is a good season for them. It seems like this is a club that could continue. That could 100%. Like, even compared to like an Everton or whatever, I'm like, they've got it planned out.
I was shocked by how well Spurs done this have done this season. I thought it was going to be United trying to push it in, and then I was completely surprised. The same with Brighton, but Brighton as well. Brighton, the amount of investment they have put into their women's game. And the new training facilities has
made
an absolute difference to their team. Hope Powell, I think she's a decent coach. I don't think she's the greatest coach.
Shout out
Hope Powell. But that on top of facilities makes the world a difference. Like, we had Tobin Heath, Kristen Press. They came from US football to Port Cabins.
When Alex Morgan joined Spurs, it was huge for them as well because she was just saying this, what we're doing right now is unacceptable. This is where we need to, like, it was something about the training facilities. She was like, this is a joke. Like, I've come from, like, the top class, world-class facilities, and you're telling me I have to play, like...
I know the league was so happy when those Americans picked up. They were just like, piss off, man. Like, you're proper outing us. Like, and I think that's... I know when Tobin... Because obviously Tobin had left, she came back, and then when they said she'd come to us, I know the league was just sitting there. You know that meme? That's like, I know that's like they were sitting there and pissed. But no. And I think it points to like the strides that the league in general is making towards making sure that like the quality is improving.
Yeah.
Because that's one thing I'd say I noticed as well. The quality between last and this year has improved. Like the spread of the quality has improved.
100%. Like the fact, I mean, there still is that thing. I mean, especially with Everton, the fact that we will go to a City, Chelsea, Arsenal, and I know the score already before we play.
Yeah, and United.
Let's not push it, so there's still a bit of that, but even the fact that Birmingham beat Arsenal.
They're playing at St Andrews next season as well. Their games.
You could not see that happening a few years ago.
Yeah,
exactly that.
And just the general, like, the mid-table teams giving the teams ahead of them a run for their money. The fact that there's Reading.
Yeah.
It's like, there's still going to be some batterings and that, but... I won't bring up the Leicester game either. But like, but the ones above Birmingham and Leicester and Everton, the rest of those mid-table teams are competing in a way that we haven't seen ever, really.
Yeah, and it's made the matches just a bit better watch in general. Yeah. Like, obviously, everyone likes when their team pummels another team. Like, it's funny. Like, everyone, it's a mixture of funny and it's a good time for like your own players to get their confidence up. Like, if you've been through a goal drought, know, drop a cheeky two on Birmingham's head, like that, you know, it improves your confidence. You're going to the next game thinking I can score goals, like even if you weren't scoring goals before. But at the same time, when there's like nowadays, they're like, oh, but Reading are a threat on the counter. This team's like, when you've got, you know, like we want there to be some fight from the other team, and I feel like we've seen that more this season.
And also, it's not like, even if there's a battering like Chelsea, Reading recently was like, 5-0, but the reverse picture of that before.
Exactly.
Completely different game. And I think that just shows you, it's like, even, I know City were in a bad run, but like West Ham beating City earlier on in the season, cool, it's looking like, as in the 2-0 recently was pretty comfortable in the FA Cup game tomorrow. I see it just being an easy walkover, but you never know. But just the fact that earlier on in the season, it went the other way, and it's like, it's not predicted. It's not like this is definitely going to happen. There is still like, there's so much more chance now that a random score can happen, which is what you want from a league. Like, you want it to be continually unpredictable.
Yeah, and the quality of the goalkeeping, because I think that's what's one of the biggest qualms that people have with women's football in general, is the quality of the goalkeeping.
Yeah.
But Ellie Roebuck, I think she was injured for a bit of the season, which influenced City's form, but Mary Earps has been great this season.
Yeah.
Like, Hannah Hampton, great goalkeepers. It's going to be a question of who starts for England. It's going to be a real question mark, because the standard of goalkeeping has improved so much. And that makes such a difference for the league as well, because you know that the chances of worldies going in, there's still a chance.
Yeah, obviously.
Like, standard Caroline Ware gets United. Please. She's going to score. She's going to score. But
I'm not
going
to lie to you.
But that goes down as well. It doesn't feel like you're watching a game of FIFA. It feels like you're actually watching a game of football, because there's quality throughout the pitch. I'm not saying they're not quality goalkeepers, but it was just such a difference between the top teams and, let's say, the teams that were just coming up from the Championship.
Yeah.
That's been, I think, I've seen, that's the biggest improvement that I've seen as well.
I completely agree. It's good you touch on City, to be fair, because they were the next team we were going to get into. Obviously, we all know City started the season really badly.
Well, we say really badly, but their first game of the season was
Everton.
And,
a cheeky four piece, I think it was.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the day that I said, Everton, because the thing is this, in fact, we're still going to City. I was going to say, Everton for now. But
generally, they started badly.
Yeah, generally, they started bad for their standard, in terms of, like, after that City game. You know, they had so many injuries, people were dropping like flies at that point. And then it was like, okay, how much is this going to impact them? Then it became a question of how much will it impact them? Because we knew City had squad depth before then.
Yeah.
So I think everyone was kind of thinking it would still be fine. Like, even though their defence is out, they just outscore teams. But they didn't realise how pivotal the whole team is, to everything they do. Their fullbacks get involved.
Yeah, yeah. I think that's also the thing of, like, when you say squad depth, obviously they've got squad depth in terms of, like, so many choices in terms of attacking, like, oh, can we put this person here on the left or off the striker, etc., etc.
Yeah.
But squad depth in that sense of, like, luxury squad depth compared to, like, when your whole back line is out.
Yeah.
Do you have like second, third choice centre back? So we're going to drag you through those games against, like, I won't say United because you lot don't particularly do well against City, but against.
We get a point every season. We get a point at home.
We basically lose three times, we lose twice, and then we somehow manage to get
a point at home from behind. Always, by the way. Always from behind, but we will get a point. Yeah. But then we get pummeled, obviously, at the Academy Stadium. So.
But in terms of, like, when they have to actually come up against teams and be consistent to keep themselves in fighting places, they didn't have that depth. But I mean, not many teams are going to have that depth when their whole back line is out. Like, they were completely unlucky. But
Stanley was at right back at one point, like, Jill Scott was at centre back. They were actually suffering. Like,
I rate Jill Scott, obviously, great, but I mean, she should not be playing.
I've got to get her out of the England team.
90s, especially at centre back.
I think it was tough as well. I think people were not downplaying it, but, like, it's like people weren't realising. If you told me that United are going to have... Like, do you remember that game when United played West Ham recently and Zellum was at centre-back? I actually thought she did a good job, by the way. Big up Katie Zellum. But if you told me she would have to play centre-back for 7 games, I promise you I'd be in tears. Like, do you get what I mean? Like, it's fair enough someone doing it once.
It's a different mentality to be a centre-back as well, because I think the big thing to be a defender... And I say this and I'm not a defender, it's concentration.
Yeah.
So if you are only in there for one game, as you said, you're focused completely. If you're there for 2 games, you're like, okay, I can do this. On 4 games, I didn't anticipate to be here. And that's where you see the little mistakes come through, because there's certain things that you can do as a centre midfielder that you cannot do as a defender. So it just creates the risk and it opens the door for mistakes. And then if your back line is shaky, it impacts the goalkeeper because they start doing risky things as well.
Yeah. But also, it's like, if in that sense, so if you've got a centre back that's hard enough filling in a centre back when you're not a centre back.
Yeah.
But if you're doing that, well, also on your right, you were used to Lucy Bronze and instead you've got Stanway. No offence to Stanway, but that's not her position.
She literally wants to be up on the other end.
And also compared to, like, Bronze, who's, like, one of the most experienced world class players in the whole league, let alone for City, it's like, that's another level to have to step into that role as centre back.
Yeah, Yeah, and I think as well, it's easier. So if I was playing centre-back and I'm not a centre-back, I think it'd be fine if I was dealing with a striker that didn't really have good movement but was just strong. Mm-hmm. So like at least at that point, you just stay with them, you just try and match them physically. But then once you start meeting strikers that run in behind and you're not a centre-back, let's be real, it's over. Like,
if you don't have experience next to you, because if your partner is so key, especially like if I was to play out of position, the first thing I would say is tell me what to do.
Even at 5-a-side, if I was asked to play defense, I'm struggling. I mean, I know I'm like 5'2", so I'm not there for defense. But yeah, it's like it's positional awareness. It's like this league isn't a joke anymore. You're not that it was a joke, but do you know what I mean?
It's more tactical. It's much more as we were speaking earlier about the American league, which is much more to and fro. It's much more you build moves and you try to drag teams out of position. That's how the league works. So if you're not experienced, it's so easy for something to just come in from behind and just do the whole defense.
Yeah.
100%.
I completely agree. So yeah, fast forward a couple months, let's say, City get their players back and they start their run essentially of just pummeling teams again. Like, this looks like City.
The dreading quarterfinals.
It's
just Caroline Ware just scores worldies against Man United. I think I have PTSD.
I'm so against Everton the other day as well.
Yeah, it's actually, I'm not going to lie to you. In that Manchester derby at City's ground, as soon as I saw her warming up, I tweeted saying, Caroline Ware's coming on. Please, if she gets the ball near the edge of the box, just foul her. Because I was like, Worldie incoming. And I remember because Courtney responded to the tweet and was like, don't say that. And I kid you not, 30 seconds later, chip the ball. I've actually had enough, because the thing with like Colin Weir's goals against United is they're so good, that they replay the goals over and over again.
It was also like, didn't she win a replica?
That's what
it's didn't like, she how did she get nominated for Oscar?
I've had enough, honest to God. Like, when I heard rumours a couple months ago that, Casey Stoney wants to bring her to America, I said, bye, please, I've had enough. Because I just don't understand. It was the exact same goal.
I looked at Mary Earps, so I was like, please stay, don't come off the line. She came off the line, it was over.
I'm not going to lie to you, look, irrespective of whether your normal goalkeeping practice is to be off the line at that moment in time, I wouldn't even look at the ball, I would have started bolting back. I would have literally turned around and been running and then run back. Because every time, and then the goal is always like either a crucial moment, to like win a game
or to take the game away.
And then to make myself, the goal is always peak. So
it's always a worldie.
So even though it happened months ago now, I saw it last week. Like, please leave me alone.
It's also the thing of like the stature of the game, because like the way it is with the women's game, obviously like men fans of the men's game, some of them who aren't like big fans of the women's game, do you know what I mean? Or they'll watch those particular games or go to those particular games when it's a Manchester derby, when it's So if you're doing that in a Manchester derby,
it's all the time.
It's hitting a new audience as well.
It's all the time.
So suddenly you're seeing like people that don't even watch women's football retweeting that goal that you don't want to see.
We had Tony Heath's goal last, which was.
And I was holding on. I was holding on to for dear life, because I was thinking, do you know how long it's been since? Because normally the goals we score against City are scruffy goals.
I'll take it though. I just want to win.
I'll take it. But Tobin's goal, was like oh my God, I was so happy. But like. No, Caroline Weir is just the thing is as well, she hadn't been playing for eight.
She was out of the team. She'd been out of the team.
She was on the bench. But as soon as I saw her warm up, I said, for God's sake, you don't understand. We've played City
it's
in
like
the
rest
league.
Now, yeah.
Rest. We've played them in the league 3 times at their ground, and she has scored in all of it. You don't understand? That first game, I remember.
Was at the Etihad.
And worldie. 33,000 people. We lost that game 1-0, and it was a worldie from her. And that was nominated for Puskas as well. That got nominated for Puskas. Last year got nominated, and I won't be surprised.
But again, I remember that one, the 1-0, it was like advertised everywhere of this is the first women's game to watch. The first Manchester
Derby.
That was the first one.
Yeah, but the next Manchester Derby, I don't know. I think Man United might let them through the door. And if we let her score a worldie like that,
I'll try. We're pissed. I'm not going to lie. I'm not going to lie. She just needs to go and butt Casey Stoney in. I've had it in San Diego. I've had enough. But Caroline Weir is a very good player, and I think that speaks to
She was great in the Conte Cup final.
That's what I'm saying. And it speaks to the depth that City have, because she wasn't in the starting 11 at one point.
Mm.
Janine Becky, who's leaving now, was not in the start. And I'm not going to lie, 95% of teams are taking Janine Becky in WSL.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, I'm definitely, like, I'm putting her on. If she would come to United, I'd say, yeah.
Even Bonnie Shaw, she doesn't start.
Whoever's on the wing needs to leave. Janine Becky's here. Sorry. This is go time. But that's what I'm saying. And it speaks to City's depth, because they have players like that at their disposal and they're not even playing. And they're not playing.
Bonnie Shaw was like a world-class international signing that the whole league was like, this is a huge signing. This is mad.
Yeah.
Starts on the bench.
She was coming at United. She was linked to United. She was linked to United.
She scored against us in the FA Cup. So do you get what I mean? Like, at this point, like, that can't be asked. I honestly can't be asked to sit anymore.
I think it says a lot though, because if you're saying it from a football fan perspective, it has been a pretty incredible run. I want it to stop because I want United to get that last spot.
Are they eight games that are lost now?
Yeah.
Eight game win streak.
That's what I'm saying. Like, and the thing is this, if we look at City's last five games or four games,
I
looked at it and I was literally thinking, four out of the five teams, I can't even see them scoring against City, let alone you're going to stop. Because my thing is, even if you score against City,
it's what's coming.
The likelihood of you outscoring City is the problem that then starts. Like, all right, you're going to, if you score, City have goals from everywhere. Like, City's midfielders score goals.
Yeah.
Stanway, do you know what I mean? Just look at what Stanway's doing right now.
Yeah.
Lauren Hemp's constant. I feel like when you play City, you're always thinking about, you know, like in basketball, when you're like, you hand over someone. You know, like if you're marking someone and you hand them over to the next person. With City, you don't even want to hand over anyone here because you're literally thinking, this person's just as peak.
Yeah, it's just as dangerous.
Like,
yeah.
You're like, all right, let's leave the right back. Oh, it's Lucy Bronze.
She's
just delivered a great cross. Oh, crap. Ellen White's headed it in. Do you know what I mean? Like, it's just, we're pissed either way. And I think that next season for City, they're going to be back to, like, what we expect from them. City were the ones before this season that were challenging Chelsea for everything.
Yeah.
Like, they were going to the, like, I think that's why Emma Hayes made that joke just before the Conte Cup semi-final, and she was like, oh, no point in the draw, we're going to get City. Because they constantly get each other in last stages of, like, cups in the league. It's always going toe-to-toe with them.
Yeah.
And I think, especially, like, after City have had this year when people have been out and they've just been coming back, I think next year for them is going to be, like...
I think Conte Cup will make a massive difference as well, because Chelsea were the dominant side going in there. And
in the first half. And in the first half.
But dominated. City were incredible. And if you think, like, if you, just that confidence you have from beating the best team in the league, it goes a long way. And that Conte Cup final was basically a Chelsea home match. There was about 25 City fans at the end.
With
their flags. It was basically a Chelsea home match. And
but it's also that inevitability, the same way we're talking about Chelsea, like, it's that mentality of no, because was it Ellen White got, you know, who hasn't even had a good season at all,
she hasn't.
Comes up with the winning goal, and it's like,
she's clutch though.
Yeah.
The things with Ellen White, it doesn't even matter how bad it is. The thing is, major comps, finals, semi-final, she's active.
She will be there.
And she'll be offside 20 times, but you see when you need her to be onside once, onside once, she's scoring.
Yeah.
She's scoring. And she doesn't care if it came off her knee, her lip. She honestly doesn't care. Like, one thing with her, she knows how to score goals in the matches that matter. Mm-hmm. Yeah, City just, oh, God. Yeah, City are great, to be honest. And I think if you hear how some of them are speaking, that's another reason why I'm not confident, though. Like,
oh, they have complete confidence.
If you hear how they're talking, you even be scared. Like, the way they're talking, you'll think they're 5 points ahead of us.
Yeah.
They're behind us. And they're still like, but we know they're still like, they were like, we know they're still got to go Chelsea. That's how they start talking. And that's what I'm saying. Like, how can we, as United fans, have confidence when they're...
Have they got
nobody.
United having a good run apart from Chelsea. So I was looking at a couple weeks back, I looked at the fixture list. I was like, we could do this. Then I scrolled down to the bottom.
Chelsea.
And so Chelsea at King's Meadow. I saw
that match from the beginning. For this whole time, as soon as City started their run, I looked at our thing and I said Chelsea last. And I said, unless we keep a healthy distance on City, that's it's done.
We should be closer to Chelsea, though. We should have beaten City, and we should have beaten Arsenal.
We should have beaten City.
Definitely, Ella Toon had a great chance to make it 2-0 against Arsenal.
Great chance. I remember it.
She great just opened chance. Up her body and just like...
And it was the one person on the pitch. It was the one person on the pitch I wanted the ball to fall to. Same. Her and Alicia Riso. And it happened.
The most clinical.
It happened. I was like, I wasn't expecting this at all.
You know, we should have scored as well in that first half as well. There was another header straight after Riso's header. We should have scored. Anyway, that's the story of United's life. And that's even what we're going to segue onto now. And I think first we have to talk about United, especially in the beginning of the season, like dropping points from winning positions. Mm. What are you guys' thoughts on that? And why do you think that was happening so much?
I think it's instability. United at the start of the season, after Casey Stoney left, I was so surprised when Casey Stoney left.
I'm not gonna lie, I shed a 1-2 tear. I was so pissed.
I still think it's Casey's team.
Same. I still follow San Diego. Only
I'm a San Diego fan.
And I hate that league. Sorry.
I'm a San Diego fan because of Casey. So when that happened and all of the turmoil that went on at United, and I think it didn't help that the men started really well because. Yeah. They were high flying as a Man United fan. I was like, oh, we might win the league this year. Then everything else happened, and then you had the women who they just about appointed the manager, and then you have to embed what Mark Skinner's vision onto players that Casey Stoney has developed. She took some of them from ashes.
Yeah, yeah. I'm not gonna lie.
She cusp championship players, and she's made them into WSL players. Yeah. So to shape that and to try and bring in your own system, it's going to take a while to change. So I'm not surprised that there was some cracks. I'm surprised that United actually did
as well as they
are
have
doing been. As well as they yeah. have done this season. Because at the end of last season, about 2 weeks before the season started, did we even have a manager? At one stage, Katie Zellum was coaching the team.
And our under-21s coach, Charlotte Healy. I'm not going to lie.
He's done a great job with the under-21. Our under-21s team is incredible.
I'm not going to lie.
It's incredible.
I think it's the best.
Oh, no, we are the best.
It is the best under-21s team. That's not even on a bias. Yeah. That's just the facts.
We smack teams.
We smack teams for fun. And I just wish that we can... Because the next step for academies, especially in the women's game in general, is the transition between going from academy players into your playing for first teams. Because that's one thing that our academy coach keeps saying, that like the aim in this all is to make WSL and championship players. So whether that's for United, obviously that would be the best case scenario. But at the end of the day, we want our players to play at the top level.
Yeah.
So wherever that may be, we want that to happen. And I think that's a good mentality to have. But obviously we want to see even more integration between academy and first team. And I think that can happen this year, especially with people like Carrie Jones, who was getting games before her injury to be fair in the Cups.
It also just takes investment. It's like when you look at so many of these academies, what is really there? And it's like in the same way we were saying, you know, there's still quite a big gap between WSL and the championship and then the lower leagues. It's like the academies often operate in the same way.
Yeah.
Whereas they're not anywhere near the standard once you get into the WSL. So much of that comes from just the most basic bit of investment. Do you have transport? Do you have facilities? Because if as a 17-year-old... you're playing in terrible conditions like that, you don't have your proper physios to a high standard, you don't have coaching to a high standard, you're on long transport and you've got to go to school or college or whatever it is the next day, then a year later you're expected to play in one of now pretty much the best league in Europe, in the world possibly either. That's such a big transition.
Yeah.
And then it's also like there isn't the same infrastructure that you can then go and play in the third division or championship for a bit in the same way that men do and like learn your craft there, because
the standards are too different. The standard is still a huge gap.
So you could go on loan to the championship for a bit, but how much are you going
to
learn?
Clubs that you could trust to be like
to develop you properly, because like, what facilities
like
do
a
you
Sheffield
have
United
there?
You could send your players to, for example. Like there's certain clubs you could send your players to in the championship, but after like probably like the top four, you wouldn't really want to.
I think transfers as well. United, and I think even Kristen Press, Tobin Heath, those were out of the blue signings. I wasn't expecting it.
That's so United, though, in general. Like, everything United do, it's random.
Yeah.
It's random.
And I think now we're seeing it at the later stage of the season, that there's big gaps in United's team. There's a reason. League tables do not lie. There's a reason why we are worried about Kings Meadow because we...
Well, we're worried about Kings Meadow because Chelsea are peak and they're better than us in literally every single avenue.
But we have the only thing that we haven't really lost over is that Lauren James... She's been injured on and off this season. So it's not been that big a loss. She's gonna score.
Just to say, those were Courtney's words. Those were not my words. I promise you, Lauren James has the capability to literally decimate the whole entire backline by herself. So I'm not speaking on that.
I'm not saying it in the way that Lauren James can't score against Man United. I'm saying it that her loss in our team has not been as big as expected.
Okay, I agree.
Because obviously she has been injured. Lauren James was a sad one to lose as well.
Because the thing is, sometimes I try and play it down. Yeah, like, you know, you already know the player's going in it. So you try to act like, yeah, it's fine. Like, she's going with our blessing. Like, it's fine. Like, we already knew she wanted to go. But at the end of the day, like, this is for her next step in her career. But the whole time I was thinking, I'm pissed because, like,
yeah.
All I was hearing on United's end was an attacker is leaving. And I was hearing a new attacker's leaving every week.
Yeah.
And then I wasn't hearing... Like, it's not like we're hearing, oh, Tobin Heath is going. United are bringing in Caroline Weir. Then I'll be like, all right, fine. We're just hearing Tobin Heath's going. Chris Press is going. Lauren James is going. And all the time we're thinking dot, dot, dot. Like,
The players have stepped up in terms of, like, Alicia Russo, Kirsty Hanson had a good season. Leah Gorton should be pressing for England's spot, I personally think.
She's the one that said that she didn't want to be considered for England.
I think she needs to say that she should be considered now. She's had such a good season. I think when we played City as well, when Leah Gorton had her little concussion, I was like... Oh.
Yeah, we're done for. Yeah.
I was like, that was such a key move. But I think United, to develop... They have to invest in that team. They need a centre midfielder. We said a couple of times who can keep the ball like a Kim Little, they need that type of player. You're not gonna recreate Kim Little, but there's nobody in our team now that I trust that can dictate the pace of the team.
I trust Jackie Grinnan, and I trust her. Probably.
But Jackie doesn't start as much as.
But that's not. Trust me, if I had my way, Jackie's starting every match.
Yeah,
every match because. The thing is with Jackie is that she literally dictates the entire tempo of that team. Like, in terms of when it's time to slow down, you'll just see her start playing, short passes, then a lovely lofted pass over to Ella Toon on the left. Like, that's what I like to see, like someone that's confident on the ball. And I feel like when she's not there, and I feel like when Hayley Ladd, for example, isn't there, who brings a lot of calmness to the midfield, that's when I feel like the game's too open. Because I actually hate that. Anyway, that's another reason I don't like end of it. So, like, I hate end-to-end games of football. Like, on the women's side. Because the thing is this, especially when it's teams of two different levels, how are you going end-to-end with a team that's so much better than you? Imagine us doing end. It's like, on the men's side, United versus Leeds, end-to-end, and then you end up losing 7-1. Do you get what I mean? That's not... That is no way for you to want to be entering a match. Like, the first thing every team should be thinking about is stability, especially in midfield. And I feel like that's where United lack when we don't play Hayley Ladd and Jackie.
We need both of them.
And then, at the same time, someone like Katie Zellum, who I don't think, in terms of being on the ball and dictating play, I don't think she's as good as Jackie.
She's not.
But you can't take away from the fact that her on set pieces is just cash money. Like, honest to God, like the stuff you don't get from Katie in midfield in terms of, like...
She'll give it to you.
I think we're still first for set piece goals for us from corners, from free kicks, from everything. The thing is, her delivery just invites pressure all the time. And the thing is, we've got people that are good at heading the ball.
Yeah, Alicia Russo, great.
Very good at heading
the ball. But that's what I'm worried about with United. They need to put in place a solid structure. I think that they are recruiting like a head director of football, because I'm worried now that if we don't make Champions League,
Onabatiye,
Emma Hayes has her eyes on her.
She's
the next person
Onabatiye. She likes Manchester as well.
James was messaging me the other day saying she was sending me tweets that are saying Barcelona have already started preparing for Onabatiye.
If she goes to Barca, I have no issues.
I said from the beginning.
But if she goes to Chelsea, I can't deal with that.
She's not going to Chelsea.
How confident are you guys in keeping some of your best players, especially if we look at like
Well,
Tune is
staying. Tune signed a new contract.
Till 2025.
Hopefully her friendship with Russo.
So because obviously with the Euros coming up as well, like, could be a big tournament for someone like Russo. It's like, are you worried that she might?
I feel like with Russo, I am worried because her quality deserves to be playing Champions League. My only bit of solace that I'm like, I don't think she will go, is that none of the top three teams need a striker.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like, I'm not saying that she can't make the... She could, but she would very tell. Easily. So, like, it before Arsenal bought Blackstenius, yeah?
Yeah.
If they'd have said they wanted Alyssa Russo, I would have been like, I get why they want her. Mm. Same as City. I could see why City would want her. But because they've all made purchases, so they bought, Arsenal bought Blackstenius, Chelsea, I mean, City bought Bunny Shaw at the start of the season. Where is the space? Unless you're going to fully commit and say, you know what, Ellen White, you've been amazing for us, unfortunately. Because you know, sometimes teams just take it, it's not about when the person, they don't wait for a person to be done.
Yeah, they're already preparing.
It's like, it's good to have a sort of second striker as well. Yeah. And then it's like they become the first striker in a season or so.
But I think United players, I think they have stepped up. They considering have. The players that we lost, like Kirsty Hansen, she's had a couple of injuries, but she's had a great season. Yeah, season. Like the players that we brought in, Hannah Blundell.
Hannah Blundell's been amazing. Eva Mannion has been amazing before the injury.
All of these players who were like second string at their teams, and they have stepped up. So I think we just need to be a bit more shrewd in our signings, and we have to make them quickly. But this is standard Man United, and this is the men feeding into the women. Is that it's not Ed Woodward anymore, but they're going to take their time and they're going to try and get the best deal, even though in the dime of the money we give to the Glazers, it's only about 25 pence in like the whole bucket of the dividends. But we need to make the Man United project seem like much more desirable, because down the road, if you were a young player and you're good, and young players in the WSL, they come into the league much younger now. Like Lauren Hemp, all of these players, Lauren James, they're all young players. Mm. And you looked and you were like, do I go to United or do I go to City? I say this as a United fan, but it hurts me to say this, but I'll go to City.
All the top three before I go. But the thing is, but then it becomes a case of, what is your priority right now at this moment in time? Like, I remember I was having this conversation with James at one point, and he was saying that before Toon signed her contract, he was like, he thinks that City are going to come in for her. And I was just saying that as good as, I think Ella Toon is fantastic, and I've been a big fan for a while now, but I just think, the way United play right now is best for her at this moment in time. I think at United, she gets the ball when she wants. And at City, you're not...
The reason
you're not going to get it is because there's someone else that can also do what you want to do. Mm. So I don't have to... I'm not going to pass you here because...
It's like the big fish in a small pond kind of thing. Yeah. But with United right now, and if they keep it up for next season as well, it's a big fish in a small pond, but it's... The pond isn't that small either.
Yeah,
and
but in a big sea. Like the pond is, you still, like, you play for one of the smaller clubs in the WSL, but then you go and play at Old Trafford.
Yeah, and also you're competing for Champions League spots. Yeah. You're going to do, probably go on a decent cup run.
You're still playing every game.
If you don't come across
Serena's
City.
Serena's literally playing her single game. That's what I'm saying. Until it starts to be that she's missing out on opportunities because of it, I think that she's content. Russo's problem is a bit different, because I think even if she moves to another team, she's not... Ellen White's inevitability is what's keeping her starting for England. And England owe her, I'll be real, because she tries to carry Great Britain on her back in those Olympics, and they threw it back in her face. So she's literally got...
So poorly.
What do they call that? She's got dividends to pay. Like, she's got money in the bank. I can have some stinkers. Yeah, I'm allowed to. That's basically what she's on right now.
But she's probably only got, after this tournament, one more tournament.
Then we still got Beth England. That's what I'm saying. Ellen White leaving then opens up the door. But Ellen White is not ready to leave yet, because she's still so efficient. On an international level, she's still so efficient. Agreed with what you were saying about United doing better than I thought they would. And let's just keep our fingers crossed on that one.
I just think that sometimes, I think the last couple of seasons, is that United have done better than people have expected. So there was one point where
I expected them to come forth
where we were pushing. No, but there was, you expect them to come forth, and then the table tells a different type of story. Yeah, so last year, looking like we were doing something, and then our heads have kind of turned.
But then Tobin Heath got injured, and then we went to shit, basically.
Then Tobin Heath got it. But even with the Arsenal game, I think it's a prime example. If we had won that game, we would have been like 3 points.
I'm not gonna lie.
And then your mind focused, because I think for now, United's aim should 100% be getting that Champions League spot.
Yeah.
Because if that happens, that changes United.
Or
everything.
Their whole
process. I'll take a cut.
I'll take anything, to be honest.
Because I'm not going to lie, there's certain times it's looked like we could. Like, obviously, you need certain things to fall in your favour, though, to win a cup in the women's side. Because
yeah.
Because there is the Arsenal, Chelsea, City, you're going to get one of
them. Yeah. And you need to hope that the draw on the other side
falls nicely, so that at least knocks one of them out.
Because we beat Arsenal and then we got Chelsea, and I was like,
I'm saying, it just never ends.
If you go on a run where you've got Arsenal, Chelsea, then City, like,
that Conti Cup, yeah, we had City in the group.
Yeah.
We made it out of the group and we got Arsenal, and then we beat Arsenal and we got Chelsea. FA Cup draw, we beat Bridgewater and then we got Man City. This is what I'm saying, like, but then the problem is we're always going to get one of those people, so at this point, to start just winning.
Yeah,
do you know what I mean? Like, that's the only way you're going to do it.
We know it was that simple.
Let's wrap up on that quickly. We're going to touch on Everton. We're not going to go to Ham because obviously they've not had the season that they would want to have.
No.
But what have your thoughts been on Everton this season?
It's just been such a weird one. It's like they showed so, like, I think everyone was excited about Everton at the beginning of the season with the signings they made. And then just being obviously to get rid of Willie Kirk, who's been there for so long. And
shout
then,
out Willie Kirk,
then. Shout out Willie Kirk, man. And then to bring in a new manager only to get rid of him a few months later.
This is a guy from Lyon.
Yeah, that was a shambles.
Complete shambles. And now we're such a weird team to watch. I feel like where we've gone wrong this season, particularly, is even aside from all the managerial issues and everything, it's like, and particularly now in the way that we're playing, I know it's an interim manager, but we're trying to do things we're not capable of doing.
Mm.
Yeah. So you can watch us for 10 minutes and go, this is a decent team, you know? Like, obviously we know player for player, they've got a lot of quality, but even in the way that they play right now, the one touch passing this team does, you'd think they're Barcelona.
Facts. And then they lose it, and then they conceded, and they cannot do
the basics. So they're trying to do things that they do not have the capabilities of. You do not have the facilities for that.
No, facts.
And so it's just such a weird team because we show promise, and then it's only promise in the sense of a few minutes of quality play, but it's not anything substantial.
Yeah.
It's not like we're showing promise of. We go 2-0 up, let in two goals, etc. So we're not even doing that. We're just passing it around quite nicely, getting to the final third, not really knowing what to do, have Tony Duggan up front playing through the centre, who just not what I thought she might be coming back into it. I thought her coming back would maybe mean... I thought it'd be a decent signing, but
I put her as my one to watch at the start of this season. I couldn't believe it.
I think she's got about 3 goals all season, something like that.
It hasn't clicked. I think the quality difference in what she was playing with when she was last in the WSL and what she's playing with now is different. But I also think it hasn't helped that you made so many signings.
Yeah.
It feels like everyone's new.
Everyone's new, and also it's like, in the positions they play as well, there's so much chopping and changing each week.
Yeah.
So we haven't even got our like core team that we're like, it's a shame because when you bring someone like Benison, someone who's got so much promise, but that's the worst type of team for a young player with potential to be in somewhere where there's no real understanding of what their roles are and what the like consistency is. That's the last thing you want for a young promising player.
You want them
player.
To just come into a system that's already working and then for them to develop in a system that is already working.
Yeah.
Whereas we're putting her in a team being like, we're actually relying on you to go and do something.
Like, we're literally, we're struggling here. We need something from you.
What do you think is going to happen like with the likes of Gabby George and all of it? Like, in terms of
she just
signs.
Loves the club. Like, she just loves Everton. So, I mean, hopefully she stays. I'll be interested to see whether we play with a back five or not next season.
Did you play with a back five at Old Trafford? It looked kind of like a... Maybe you didn't play with it, But I think the setup ended up looking as though.
Like, yeah. Started very well defensively against United.
Yeah, they did.
But again, it's the same set pieces.
I still thought we'd get back into that game though. And that's the thing.
We scored in the first 3 minutes, you know. It's not good.
You guys looked consistently dangerous on the counter in that match.
You look good. I was surprised.
I was worried.
But again, like the basics, and you also had a goal that shouldn't have been disallowed. It was not offside.
Martha Thomas, I know she was.
And it's just the complete basics. It's just like, and the same with City the other day. It's like, not only is it set pieces, but it's just crosses. Like the moment the ball comes in, no one knows what they're doing. No one knows who they're marking. It's like,
the basics.
Such simple things.
You need someone to take responsibility though in those situations, and especially.
I also find that when we play with a back five, it's like, because of this one touch passing, you just end up in a position where there's no one really in the middle. Because like it's not three in the middle, it's two in the middle. Mm. So then, as a result, the moment you lose it, just one ball through the middle, our fullbacks are already up, and it's just you're done for.
Yeah.
Anyway, it's been a weird season, but we got a new manager now coming in.
I've heard good things about him, so
And I think he, hopefully, from what I've heard, he's the just kind of person who brings good support. And develops young players well, which is what we need. We've got so many young players at the moment.
Yeah.
I think what could be key is that the men stay up as well, because
don't get me started.
Traditionally speaking, women's teams always get cut first when teams get relegated. It's a terrible thing. Yeah. But when Charlton got relegated, their women's team got gutted.
Yeah.
Their women's team got gutted, and it will be the opposite to see how Liverpool do coming up.
Mm.
But I think Everton, just in general in terms of the men, I think they will stay up. Same. But if they don't, then
we definitely have still to worry about. Let's not go that far. What I would say in terms of not worrying is, I feel like Everton women have such a history. I mean, I know Charlton did as well, but have such a history, and also the way that it's set up, they do have their own sort of, like, they have their own sponsors compared to Everton men. They have set them up as a club.
Yeah.
I think there are a lot of problems, and that's shown in the way that it's been managed this year. But I do feel like there is still some remnants of, like, it's not completely reliant on the men. There should be enough of a structure there for Everton women that it wouldn't just be gutted. But of course, in terms of, like, would their investment be the same? And also just with Everton men, it's like the amount of money we've put into the new stadium, etc., etc. Yeah. What would actually happen to Everton as a club, as a whole? Other thing that I don't want to get into or think about. But hopefully, we wouldn't do that to our women's team. But I mean, we've seen it enough times in the past.
But I think the eyes as well that are on women's football right now.
Look at what happened at Coventry.
We come under a lot of scrutiny.
I think just to avoid that, even if that's the reason, just to avoid it.
Yeah.
But that's basically what we've got time for today. But we're going to do three quick fire questions for the two of you. First question, who wins the league this year?
Chelsea.
Second question, who gets the last Champions League spot?
City.
As a United fan, I have to say United.
And third question, who gets relegated from the league this season?
Birmingham.
Oh yeah. In fact, let's do a surprise, not a surprise, but a random final quick fire question as well. Who has been your standout player this season? We'll go Martha first.
It depends what we're basing it on, because obviously we'll do
standout player and then most improved. We'll do standout player first though.
Standout player, obviously, you just got to go with someone like Kerr. Like, I don't know who else is really matching her.
Mm.
But in terms of most improved, I might even say Stanway, just because of consistency of her new position in midfield. Like, her being in and out of the England team and then to come in now and just be doing a job both club and country in a position that she's like, no, this is the position I want to fight for. And just dragging City up now, basically.
Okay. Courtney, stand-up player?
I say Lauren Hemp. She is incredible.
Electric.
And she's a player that regardless, is everybody is petrified. Your team could be 4-0 yeah. down and you're afraid that Lauren Hemp has the ball. I'm yeah. very excited to see what she does at the Euros this year because she wasn't really in the World Cup squad. So I'm excited for that. I'd say most improved, I'm going to go Hannah Blundell because she wasn't really in the Chelsea team, but she has been a defensive rock for United. And yeah. I think they ran her stats the other day about the number of assists that she's had. Mm-hmm. And
Most defender with the most yeah. assists.
And I think defensively, apart from the last couple of games, United have looked really solid. So yeah. I'm going to give it to a United player.
I'm going to go for standout player. I'm going to do a hybrid because I'm going to cheat because I made the rules. and I'm going to go for Kerr and... No, and let me just go for Kerr. Let me just six rules. But most improved, I'm doing two players and I don't care. Most improved, I'm going to go for Ella Toon, who despite the fact that she had a good season last year, I think she's really stepped up and I think she's become someone that you can depend on to either create goals or score goals, which has been good. And a second player that I'm going to give most improved to is Jess Carter. And that's because last year I thought she was shaky. I thought she was really good at set pieces and crossing, but I thought defensively sometimes she looked more suspect. And I feel like this year she looks like someone that's confident.
Yeah.
And I think that that's translating well on the pitch right now. So, yeah.
Do you think she starts for England?
No.
but she makes my squad of 23.
Yeah.
And she, if my right back gets injured, she starts for me. Yeah, this has just been a great first episode. The second episode, we're going to touch on some stuff that we didn't touch on today because you know how it gets when you start talking and things like that. Second episode, we're going to be touching especially on like Lionesses and things like that and the Euros. But yeah, this has been a great first episode. Thank you guys for joining me. Okay. If you just want to drop your names on socials again so people can follow.
Marva at Marva MSK.
Courtney at Cat is 11.
And I've been Moyo at Moyo's Laboratory. And of course, follow up Gold Diggers. Follow up Gold Diggers on Twitter. No, Gold Diggers UK on Twitter and Gold Diggers UK _ on Instagram. Yeah. Thank you. Don't be surprised if I ask what a bag is.